When people think about the end of the world, they often think about a nuclear apocalypse, a world so deadly that only cockroaches remain. And when we look at the fossil record, the cockroaches and other insects did survive incredibly well, surviving even mass extinctions like the one that killed the dinosaur with barely a blip in their total numbers. However, there was one extinction that they were phased by, an extinction so severe that it is still the most significant event to ever occur on the face of planet Earth. And so what can we learn for today from the time that nearly everything on Earth died? A mass extinction is defined as any time more than 50% of species go extinct. And since the Cambrian period, 550 million years ago, this has only happened about 5 times, with the Permian-Triassic mass extinction being the most severe. During the extinction 252 million years ago, about 75% of life on land went extinct, while in the oceans, over 90% of life did. And so this can be compared to the extinction that killed the dinosaurs at the end of the Cretaceous, 66 million years ago, in which 75% of ocean life went extinct. From this, we can tell that the Permian-Triassic extinction was a much more significant event than the impact that killed the dinosaurs 66 million years ago. And so by understanding it, we can get better ideas of what to do today. And that starts with understanding the causes. Global warming, the burning of fossil fuels, drought, ozone depletion, and acid rain all contributed to this extinction, which should be alarming considering some of the events we've seen around the world today. To be specific for global warming was caused by the Siberian Traps, a series of volcanoes coming from northern Russia. And these aren't normal volcanoes. These aren't even Mount St. Helens-sized volcanoes, or even Yellowstone-sized volcanoes. These are significantly larger. These volcanoes released so much lava that it could cover my entire home state of Arizona a kilometer thick. So this is something significantly larger than any of the other impacts we've seen from modern-day volcanoes. The eruptions of these volcanoes released a lot of different gases into the atmosphere, such as carbon dioxide and sulfur dioxide. However, there was even more on top of that was released. Evidence has shown that these volcanoes were also sitting on top of coal deposits, and they lit these coal deposits on fire. Fly ash taken from the Sverdrup Basin in Canada has shown to be remarkably similar to the same kind of ash pollutants that we get from coal-burning power plants in the present day. This means that these volcanoes, in addition to already releasing a massive quantity of gases into the atmosphere, were also burning fossil fuels, releasing even further particulates and CO2 gases into the atmosphere. Once in the atmosphere, CO2 can dissolve into the water to form carbonic acid. While not strongly acidic, it does react with calcite, which many animals use to form their shells and exoskeletons in the oceans, such as the corals, brachiopods, and gastropods. So the external skeletons of these animals were being significantly weakened by the acidification of the oceans. And if the animal is small or young enough, it couldn't even form this skeleton in the first place. This same kind of ocean acidification is what we see damaging many reefs around the world, such as these reefs in Key West. There was also widespread anoxia, a lack of oxygen in the water column. In order to breathe underwater, animals take oxygen from the atmosphere that has been dissolved into the water and extract it from the water column. This is not nearly as efficient as breathing the atmosphere and taking oxygen in from the gas. And so significant changes in the amount of oxygen in the water column has a very big impact on life in the oceans. Minerals such as pyrite, which contains iron, are very prevalent in the late Permian sediments of the oceans. And this iron would much more readily react with oxygen rather than sulfur to form pyrite. This indicates that there was much more sulfur in the water than there was oxygen, displacing it and potentially even eliminating the oxygen in many regions. This caused many animals to essentially be unable to breathe and die out very rapidly over the course of a few thousand years. A large amount of the sulfur that formed the pyrite would have been released from the eruptions of the Siberian Traps directly, and once in the atmosphere, would also aid in the acidification of the oceans and also in causing acid rain on land. Acid rain has been shown to be incredibly damaging to many kinds of trees, such as spruce trees, which very much resemble and are very closely related to the conifers that dominated much of the End Permian. With the continued burning of fossil fuels releasing sulfur dioxide into the atmosphere, both at power plants and for transportation, acid rain has become more common, and it needs to be something that we take into consideration when we're trying to address what may be modern-day causes of extinction. In addition to sulfur, the volcanoes also released chlorine gas. Chlorine reacts with ozone in the atmosphere and begins to deplete the ozone layer, which protects us from ultraviolet radiation. The amount of chlorine released during the Permian extinction has been estimated to cause up to 400% more ultraviolet radiation to reach the equator, and up to 5,000% more ultraviolet radiation to reach the poles, causing a very dangerous and deadly landscape for many animals that lived during the time period. In plants, this had devastating consequences. Many fossilized seeds from the End Permian show signs of mutation and malformity. They were essentially sterilized and unable to grow into adult plants. By comparing the seeds that had been fossilized with modern day seeds that were exposed to very high amounts of ultraviolet radiation, it's been more or less confirmed that this is the cause for the fossilized seeds to have become sterilized. The modern ozone layer has also been a threat though. So much so that the Montreal Protocol was signed and finalized in 1987 to try and limit the production and release of gases that threaten to react with and deplete the ozone layer. The protocol hasn't been as successful as expected though, with the ozone recovery being much slower than we had previously expected it to be. We need to continue monitoring the health of the ozone layer so that this same kind of plant sterilization that happened in the Permian doesn't happen today to our modern day crops, such as rice, corn, and wheat, which we rely on to try and feed people across the world. The release of CO2 from both the Siberian traps and the underlying coal beds which caught on fire produced an incredible amount of global warming, with ocean temperatures near the equator regularly reaching about 104 degrees Fahrenheit or 40 degrees Celsius, effectively acting like a jacuzzi at the surface of the water. On land, many terrestrial animals shifted about 10 to 15 degrees of latitude northward or southward, depending on which pole was closer, because the center of the continent at the equator was just so hot. Migration to colder climates is something we've seen in the more modern day as well, with some Peruvian mountain birds migrating to higher elevations in the mountains to avoid the worst heat at the lower elevations. The effects of climate change aren't just limited to the birds. One very familiar to me coming from Arizona is drought. During the Permian, there were massive droughts, and we can tell this because of the braided river stream beds that we find coming from the End Permian. When rivers flow without plants to help hold the banks together, they become braided and spread out over a larger area. Whereas a nice meandering river will be held in place by the plants that line its banks, a braided river is unrestricted in this way and spreads over a larger area. The Permian riverbeds we find show this kind of formation. Without the plants there to hold them, they are becoming more braided and less regulated. Well, yes, this does mean there was flowing water. It also means that these rivers were more prone to flash flooding and having very low periods as well, as there wasn't the root and plant material underneath to try and help hold the riverbed together and stop water from filtering through the many layers of sediment beneath them. Additionally, it shows that there was a mass die-off of many of the plants that should have been growing around these rivers, and that just because there's water doesn't mean that you're going to necessarily find life. This compares to today very well, with California having just ended a 7-year drought last year, and with parts of Central America seeing drought that is causing many refugees to flee the region because they can no longer grow food to support their families. Other disasters that would have affected the End Permian extinction would be things like massive wildfires. And while many animals could have been able to flee from the fires, the plants couldn't. And so charcoal beds from this time period do indicate that there were fires. However, the extent these fires had on the extinctions is debated. It's also important to consider the fact that California and Spain over the last summer have had massive wildfires as well, And so this is something where in the modern day, we are seeing the same kind of behavior of regular wildfires taking place and being incredibly damaging to an environment. And then of course there's things like hurricanes. While it's hard to be totally certain that some of the deposits we are seeing are from hurricanes or storm surges, it does seem likely that this kind of global warming would have very likely contributed to an increase of massive storms in the Permian. Similarly today, we have storms like Hurricane Maria, which devastated Puerto Rico, or the Cyclone Idai, which hit Mozambique in March 2019. And as of recording in April 2019, it's been held responsible for over 1,000 deaths, while major parts of the city of Beira are still flooded from that hurricane. Disasters like wildfires and hurricanes thrive on heat, and with the continued global warming because of human-caused activity and release of CO2 and other greenhouse gases, we are only worsening the effects that these disasters are going to have in the future. Now, fortunately, we do have some ability to limit this. The large portion of CO2 that's being released into the atmosphere is caused by human activity. So if we can try and move away from many of the fossil fuels that release these greenhouse gases, we will be in a much better position to address climate change and future extinctions. However, there's a lot of pull and pushback against this. While some people may argue that current climate change isn't human-caused, as I mentioned with the Siberian Traps earlier, they could cover my entire state with lava. And I know it's hot here in Arizona, but it isn't literally lava. Humans are releasing the CO2. There are no other places where there are massive volcanoes like this releasing gases into the atmosphere. So it must be us. Nowhere on the planet is there any place where there are volcanoes of the same size that occurred during the Permian-Triassic extinction or any of the other very significant warming events that have happened in Earth's past. Only 50 million years ago, the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum occurred. The production of CO2 at the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum was about 0.2 gigatons per year. This was caused by the pulling away of Greenland from the rest of Northern Europe, opening large fissures in the earth which allowed lava and gases to flow out. The current production of CO2 under human-caused activity from the burning of fossil fuels is about a whole gigaton, meaning we are 5 times worse than the most significant warming event in Earth's history for the last 65 million years. Vietnam recently experienced its hottest day on record at over 43 degrees Celsius. The average temperature for this time of year in Vietnam is 27 degrees Celsius. In Fahrenheit, that's about a 30 degree difference, with it being 30 degrees warmer than what is standard for this time of year. Recent studies have even suggested that as the climate continues to increase in temperature, places like Southeast Asia and Vietnam, which are very humid, will become completely uninhabitable by humans, because the combination of temperature and humidity would make people even laying in the shade experience heat stroke. And so we wouldn't even be able to survive there. As for other ways humans are influencing extinction, we can look at the insects. In my intro, I mentioned how the end Permian extinction is the only time the insects experienced a mass extinction, and that may not be the case. Due to specific campaigns targeting insects with pesticides and other measures, insects have lost a significant amount of their populations over the last 50 to 60 years. And while that doesn't necessarily mean that they're experiencing a mass extinction right now, they might be. It's hard to tell because when we first started many of these campaigns, there wasn't very good data on how populous these populations were. While we don't have good numbers for the population changes that have occurred in the insects, it does seem possible that they may be experiencing a mass extinction. And that's something we need to take into consideration. However, I will say, as they are insects and do breed rapidly, there is a better chance at recovery for the insects than many other groups. Two recent rediscoveries in February really exemplify this. One being the world's largest bee, showing how these very small animals can continue to live and even form colonies as bees do, and become successful by hiding away from where human activity is happening. The other one is the opposite. The rediscovery of the Fernandina Island tortoise has been cause for celebration, Not seen since 1906, the species was believed extinct, until one was more recently seen this past February. However, tortoises don't necessarily breed very quickly, and as they do live a long time, it could be possible that this newly found tortoise, as there was only one seen, may just be the last of its species, living from the time that people had last seen it in 1906 up until today. Even if this tortoise isn't the last of her kind, it's still not reassuring that we haven't found any others, as you would expect some population growth at least over 100 years, even when an animal as slow breeding as tortoises can be. This just goes to show how different species affected by human activity won't get the same chance at recovery as others, and how human activity has probably already doomed some species to extinction, which is something we need to consider when trying to take action to improve the wildlife and natural environments around us. Human-caused activity and human-caused climate change is having a real impact, and it's having that impact today. The extinction 252 million years ago can help inform us about some of the changes that we might see and hopefully inform us on what we can do to address them. Yet, many of our leaders still don't want to believe that climate change is a real thing. And that's something we need to address, because this climate change that happened during the Permian had very rapid effects. One locality in China shows that this extinction happened over potentially just a few hundred years, with fossils becoming incredibly abundant in the earlier layers of rock, and then almost instantaneously disappearing entirely. Meanwhile, we've seen coral reefs go from visible from shore just 120 years ago to almost non-existent today in places like the Florida Keys. As for wildlife, we've seen a 60% loss of wildlife in just the last 40 years. We need to be prepared to take direct action on climate change. It's not a matter of believing it or not. It's a matter of addressing something that is happening, because these extinctions are happening. Animals being pressured out of their environments is happening. The worsening of storms and hurricanes is happening. And we need to be able to take this direct action to prevent deaths from those storms, from drought, from starvation when people are no longer able to grow crops. If we don't take direct actions, millions of people could die or starve or be displaced. An indecisive action means no action in this case. So please, do what you can to support moving towards greener energies, and do what you can to try and support the ending of the burning of fossil fuels. Hi everyone, thanks for watching. Climate change, it's a big thing and a real thing that's happening. And we've seen from the Permian extinction, it can have very terrible effects. If we want to try and be good caretakers for the Earth, we need to learn from the past of the Earth too. A lot of people look at the dinosaurs and go, oh, it was a meteor. Well, as long as that doesn't happen, we'll be fine. And that's not necessarily the case. Part of doing this video has been a project for my honors class. So if you're ever in that honors class, my professor might show it and go, oh, I taught him. So that'll be neat. Anyway, everyone out there, I know I get a little dark with the end of the world stuff with climate change, but do take care, be safe, and don't go extinct.